Good evening, church. So good to have you with us tonight again as we continue our master classes. And I'm going to continue to actually talk about another aspect of our response to the atonement of Christ tonight. So we've talked for the last couple of weeks. We mentioned about how repentance and faith are both responses to this. But there's a third thing that Jesus mentions in that we see in the New Testament that is a response to his provision of the atonement for us, because first he calls us to repentance, then faith towards God, but then that's actually followed by this teaching on baptism. In Hebrews chapter 6, it talks about baptism actually being one of the foundational elementary teachings that is mentioned directly after the teaching on repentance and then faith. So when we look at the word baptism or to baptize in the Greek language, it actually means simply to immerse or to plunge or to saturate. So when we look at Jesus's baptism in Matthew chapter 3, verse 16, it says, when he had been baptized, Jesus came up immediately from the water, again talking about how he had been immersed in the water, and behold, the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting upon him. So we see right away that the way Jesus was baptized was actually by being immersed. And again, we see that in the even the use of the New Testament word simply meaning to be saturated or to plunge into or to be immersed. But when we talk about baptism, I want to start by simply saying, why is it necessary for us to be baptized in water? This was an elementary, fundamental teaching of the New Testament church. So why is it really that necessary for us? Why was it such a big deal in the New Testament? Well, first of all, back in for the Jews in Jesus's day, they actually understood the significance behind this idea of water baptism, because their baptisms would often include exhortations and prayers and those kind of things. And they actually believed that you really did become a brand new person and that your life began again right after your baptism. John the Baptist, of course, baptized a lot of people, and his baptism was one of repentance. But the reality is that your salvation doesn't depend upon your baptism. However, baptism is an outward evidence of the proof of your life of faith and obedience to God. So if we ask ourselves, why should we be baptized? Why is this a big deal? Well, first of all, we see in the New Testament that Jesus modeled it. In Matthew 3, 13, the verse I just read down to 17, we see the story of his baptism. And see, Jesus didn't need to be baptized in that sense because he was not a sinner. So his baptism in that sense wasn't because he had sinned and repented and needed to turn around. But Jesus still got baptized because he did it as an example for us to follow. The second thing we see in the New Testament is that not only did Jesus do it, not only did he set an example, but he also commanded it. In Matthew 28 and in Mark 16, we see him directly give a command to say, go out and baptize all people in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. See, baptism is simply put an act of obedience in response to his command. Mark 16, 16 actually says, whoever believes and is baptized is saved. That's what Jesus said in Mark 16. We also see in the New Testament that the apostles commanded it. I've listed some scriptures on the screen for you to read there, but from Acts 2, again in Acts 8, and in Acts 10, we see that the followers of Jesus carried on that practice of baptism throughout the New Testament church. And of course, fourthly, it is a public declaration that you are a follower of Christ. We see that again in Acts chapter 2, Hebrews 6, and Mark 16, 16. So we know that it's a model and something for us to follow, but I want to actually dive into just briefly what happens in that moment of baptism. So first of all, it is a moment where we experience complete identification with Jesus Christ. Galatians 3:27 says this, for as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. So in other words, when we are baptized into Christ in that baptism in water, we are putting on Christ. We're identifying with him. We're taking on his nature. And it's basically a ceremonial meaning that once you are baptized, you're now committing to follow Jesus for the rest of your life. The reality is that baptism doesn't make you a Christ follower. It just shows that you already are one. Ephesians 2, verse 8 and 9 says, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It's the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast." In other words, there's nothing we can do to make us saved. Getting baptized isn't getting you saved, as some practices would say. But in other words, it just shows that you are already following Christ and that you are declaring that. The second thing that happens at baptism is that we believe that it gives you a special grace to overcome sin. And you receive that oftentimes in that moment of baptism. There's something that's released on your life to overcome sin. In Romans 6, verse 2 to 7, and Colossians 2, verse 11 and 12, it actually talks about this. But when you are baptized, you actually identify with the death, with the burial, and with the resurrection of Christ. So going down into the water is identifying with Jesus dying. Being under the water is identifying with Jesus being in the grave, and then coming up out of the water is identifying with his resurrection power. So you rise up of that water with a fresh empowerment, because the same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead is now alive and working in you, and it dwells in you. And Romans 6 doesn't say that you cannot sin, but it does state that you do not have to sin because you are dead to sin. You don't owe it to sin to keep doing it. And so there's something very powerful in this moment of baptism where God empowers you when you declare to the world and you declare to the heavenlies in this act of obedience that I am now dead to sin. My old is gone. My old lifestyle is gone. And I'm rising up out of those waters of baptism to make a declaration that I'm going to live for Christ and for Christ alone. And I believe with all my heart that God loves that moment. And he gives you this incredible power and grace to overcome sin. The third thing that happens in baptism is that it's a death to our old life, and our new life begins. Again, from Romans and Colossians, you see that on the screen. But baptism is truly like a turning point for your life, because the old is gone and the new has come. Jesus talks about how we can be a new creation in him, because it's his desire not that we keep dragging our old life into our new life with him, but that we actually put to death those old habits through his power, through his grace, not of works, so that we can boast, but by relying and surrendering completely and totally to him. And the fourth thing that happens is not only do we identify with Jesus, but 1 Corinthians 12, verse 13 to 14, sorry, 12 to 13, talks about how we can now identify with the body of Christ. See, baptism is more about joining Jesus than joining in the church. However, this verse in 1 Corinthians actually talks about the significance of being baptized into the body of Christ, as that verse says. Because baptism connects us with the family of God, with his people here on earth. So getting baptized in water is an incredibly significant event for any believer's life. But the reality is that oftentimes when we've talked about baptism in church circles, we've limited it to just water baptism, and it is a powerful event. It is something that we should do as believers. And so if you haven't been baptized yet, I want you to contact us. You can email me directly at sandra@impactkingston.com. We'd love to chat with you about how you can get water baptized, because it's an incredible, amazing event and a significant event in your life as a Christian. But I want to read to you from Acts chapter 2, verse 38, and show you that the Bible talks about something not just regarding water baptism, but there's a different kind of baptism that Jesus has provided for us as well. It says in Acts 2:38, Peter replied, "Repent and be baptized, each one of you," which is what we've talked about, the repentance and then being baptized, "every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins." And then there's this little phrase, "and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." So as we talk about this doctrine of baptism, or the teaching of baptisms, I want to point out the fact that in Hebrews chapter 6, it doesn't just mention baptism as in water baptism, because that's significant, but it talks about the teaching or the doctrine of baptisms. And what I want to also show you tonight is that there's something incredibly significant that happens when we are baptized, not just in water, but baptized in the Holy Spirit. And so when we talk about a Holy Spirit baptism, some people get a little bit uncomfortable because it's not as tangible as water baptism. And there's lots of different types of teachings out there. And some people may say, well, do I have to be baptized in the Holy Spirit? And my answer is, no, you don't have to. But it's not so much about that you have to as it is that you get to. God desires for us to have the complete fullness of Christ in everything that he has provided for us to do his work on earth. Ephesians 4, verse 11 to 13 talks about how he has provided these gifts to the body of Christ that will help the body of Christ grow up and mature to become mature people, mature Christians, and come into the fullness of the measure and of the stature of Jesus Christ. In other words, he wants us to not just stay like spiritual infants at the beginning part of our Christian journey, but he wants us to grow into the fullness and maturity, and actually talks about perfection meaning maturity into what he has for us. And so part of that is when it comes to the teaching on something like the Holy Spirit and the baptism of the Holy Spirit, it's about showing us that there's more. That there's always more for us as believers, that we don't ever have to feel like we've hit a plateau and that there's nothing more for us. But tonight, I want to just take you on a quick journey. This is not so much a teaching on the Holy Spirit as it is just a quick journey on why the baptism of the Holy Spirit is so important for us today, because we do see it throughout the New Testament. So first of all, I want to show you that John the Baptist talked about a baptism that was different than water baptism. He talked about a baptism with Holy Spirit and fire. In Matthew 3:11, we see that he said that I baptize you with water for repentance, but after me comes one who is more powerful than I, whose sandals I'm not worthy to carry, and he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. So in other words, John the Baptist said, I perform this baptism of repentance, and that's good. It's needed. It's fundamental. It's necessary. But there's one that comes after, and he's going to baptize you in a whole different way with the Holy Spirit and with fire. So that was John declaring that that was to come. And then we see Jesus, when he's on the scene, he actually tells them that the disciples will be baptized with the Holy Spirit, which will empower them to be witnesses for the kingdom of God. In fact, he said, you need to wait for this in order to be effective witnesses for Christ. In Acts chapter 1, verse 4 and 5, and then verse 8, it says, on one occasion, while he was eating with him, this is Jesus after the resurrection, he gave them this command, do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. In other words, Jesus said, wait for that promise because you are going to need the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. You need the baptism of the Holy Spirit to do everything that I've called you to do. And then we see in the book of Acts, I just want to take you on this quick journey to see how this unfolded. We see in the upper room, there's this incredible experience, Acts chapter 2 on the day of Pentecost. I'm going to read it to you. It says, when the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. And then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat upon each of them. And they were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. In other words, this is the experience they had in the upper room on the day of Pentecost. It included fire. Remember, John the Baptist had said that Jesus will baptize with the Holy Spirit and fire. They saw tongues of fire, and they were actually speaking in tongues as the Holy Spirit gave them utterance. And then we see in the book of Acts, as we go on, that this was an incredibly vivid thing that happened in the believers' lives. They knew that the Holy Spirit baptism was actually part of what happened as a Christian because they recognized that they could not do what Jesus had asked them to do without not just being baptized in water as a declaration of their faith, but being baptized with the power of the Holy Spirit so that they had the empowerment to continue to carry out his mission. Let's read what happened in Acts chapter 4, verse 31. It says, when they had prayed, the place where they were assembled together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they spoke the word of God with boldness. In other words, the Holy Spirit is given to us so that we can have the boldness that God wants us to have. And it says here that when they had prayed, the place was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God with boldness. And some of these people were the very same people that had been there in the upper room on the day of Pentecost, but they knew they consistently needed an infilling of the Holy Spirit because they recognized they needed his power. And the other thing that we see in Acts chapter 8 is that, again, here they were baptized in water, and then they realized that there was something more. Let's hear what it says here in verse 14 to 17. It says, now, when the apostles who were at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent Peter and John to them, who, when they had come down, prayed for them, listen, that they might receive the Holy Spirit. For as yet he had fallen upon none of them. They had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. In other words, they had been water baptized, but they recognized that there was something else. There was something more for them. So it says in verse 17, then they laid hands on them and they received the Holy Spirit. See, they were already baptized in water, but not in the Holy Spirit yet. So in verse 17, we see that they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. And what was so interesting about this is that it produced some kind of tangible result in the way they lived, because we see a few verses later that Simon the sorcerer, who was used to just tapping into these supernatural powers, he was so intrigued by what that happened to those disciples that he actually wanted to buy that gift. And that didn't go well, just so you know. You cannot buy the gift of God, but you can surrender to Jesus and then he'll release everything that he has for you. As we go on through the book of Acts, we actually see another experience when Saul becomes Paul. In Acts chapter 9, verse 17 and 18, it says, then Ananias went his way and entered the house and laid his hands on him. This is speaking of Saul after he had had that encounter with Jesus on the road to Damascus, or Damascus these days. And it says that Ananias laid his hands on him and he said, brother Saul, the Lord Jesus who appeared to you on the road as you came has sent me to you that you may receive your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit. And immediately there fell from his eyes something like scales, and he received his sight at once, and he arose and was baptized. See, this is the moment where Saul receives his sight. He becomes Paul, and he's also filled with the Holy Spirit. And then he's like, wow, I got the whole package, so let's go ahead and get baptized. He actually got baptized in the Holy Spirit before he was baptized in water, but he recognized he wanted it all. And so the apostle Paul, who used to be Saul, knew that he could not do what God had called him to do without receiving everything that Jesus was providing for him. And then in Acts chapter 10, just to continue this journey through the book of Acts, we see that the Holy Spirit didn't just fall on the Jews, didn't just fall on the covenantal people of God, but God actually released the Holy Spirit upon the Gentiles, which to us is great because most of us would fall into that category. But the reality is that God wanted to release his power on everybody, on you and on me. And it's not for a secluded group of people. But in Acts chapter 10, verse 44 to 48, it says, while Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit fell upon those who heard the word. See, this was incredible. He was just preaching, and the Holy Spirit just started falling on people and baptizing people in the Holy Spirit as he was preaching the word. That's pretty incredible. And those of the circumcision who believed were astonished. So the Jews, in other words, they were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out on the Gentiles also. Again, because God desires to pour his power out on everybody. For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. And then Peter answered, saying, can anyone forbid water that these should not be baptized, to have received the Holy Spirit just as we have? And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord. And then they asked him to stay for a few days. So in other words, while Peter was preaching, the Holy Spirit fell upon the Gentiles that were there, and they started just magnifying and glorifying God and speaking in tongues. And then they all went and got water baptized because they recognized that this was part of the package, if you will, that God provided for them. And then the last example I want to show you in the book of Acts is from Acts chapter 19, verse 5 and verse 1 down to 6. It says, "And it happened while Apollos was at Corinth that Paul, having passed through the upper regions, came to Ephesus. And finding some disciples, he said to them, 'Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?' And so they said to him, 'We have not as much as heard whether there's a Holy Spirit.' And he said to them, 'Into what then were you baptized?' So they said, 'Into John's baptism,'" remember, which was a baptism into repentance. "And then Paul said, 'John indeed baptized with a baptism of repentance, saying to the people that they should believe on him who would come after him, that is on the Lord Jesus.' And when they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus." So they were actually baptized in water again. "And when Paul laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them and they spoke with tongues and prophesied." In other words, Paul comes to these believers. Remember, these are believers. They're not unbelievers. They're people that are already Christians. And they said, "Well, we've been baptized into repentance. We've done that. And we're living for God. We believe in Jesus." But Paul says to them, "But there's another baptism. There's something else for you that you have yet to experience. And that is the baptism of the Holy Spirit." So he laid hands on them. And we see instantly they were filled with the Holy Spirit. They spoke with tongues and they prophesied. So I just want to show you, church, that not only has God provided this incredible way for us to respond to him by repentance and by having faith toward God, but we can also get baptized in water as a sign of that faith and of that turning toward Christ. But then there's more, and it's what is talked about, and we see it so clear here in Acts chapter 19, that not only are we called as Christians to be baptized in water, but Paul literally says right here that there's more, that there's something else that we can experience. So when you're born again, the Holy Spirit takes residence in you. But when you have the baptism of the Holy Spirit, it's an experience subsequent to salvation. It's not just receiving the Spirit of God at salvation, but there is a whole other experience that God wants you to have, because it's going to empower you to do all that he has called you to do. So another way to say it would be that when you're born again, you have the Holy Spirit. But when you're baptized in the Holy Spirit has you. So in other words, when you're born again, you have the Holy Spirit. But when you're born and baptized in the Spirit, then he has you. He has all of you. There's a level of surrender and empowerment that comes with the baptism of the Holy Spirit that is very powerful. See, in the early church, believers usually repented, believe the gospel, were baptized in water, and in the Holy Spirit as one package. See, we have to come back to the basic and fundamental truth that the early church walked in, and they walked it out every day. As we see the early church history, this is what they lived. They repented, they believed, they got baptized, they received the Holy Spirit, because it was always meant to be a foundational part of the Christian experience. See, the very word used for the Holy Spirit in the Greek is parakletos, which means the helper or the comforter. And it also means one calls out to one's side or aid. In other words, the Holy Spirit is there because he wants to be your helper. He wants to be your comforter. He wants to be by your side and help you. John 14:26 says this, "But the helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name," this is Jesus talking, "he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you." Again, remember that this is not a teaching about who the Holy Spirit is and all the different things that he does. I just want to show you tonight that when we talk about the doctrine or teaching of baptisms, that there is something that God wants every believer to experience. And it is the empowerment, the helper, the comforter that will come when you surrender completely to God and receive the full power of the Holy Spirit. There's something incredibly powerful that kicks in to your life. And so how do we receive the Holy Spirit's power? I just want to wrap up tonight's teaching with this. First of all, you must be born again. Obviously, this is a gift for those who believe. As we saw in the New Testament, occasionally there was people that were not believers that tried to access the power of God, and that never went well because the Holy Spirit is poured out as a gift to those who are in relationship with Jesus Christ. The second thing is this. I believe that we need to just hunger after God and seek the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And you can see some verses on the screen if you want to read more about that. But God is a gentleman, and he will never force himself on you in a way that you're not prepared for, that you don't desire. So what he looks for is the hunger of God to seek after him, to desire the more of him, and he'll meet you at your level of faith. And the third thing is that we must ask in faith. See, I know this has been a teaching that has had a lot of controversy over the years. And so sometimes people are quite fearful and don't really know if they want to have that encounter with the Holy Spirit in that level. And so just know that it's okay wherever you're at in your journey. But when you do come to a point that you start hungering and seeking after that particular experience, do so by having faith that God is faithful and that he will meet with you when you have that that desire and that faith. The fourth thing is this, that you must dedicate yourself to God and surrender every part of your life to God so that the Holy Spirit won't be hindered in your life. See, God doesn't just want part of us. He wants all of us. And so I would encourage you, if this is something that you're seeking after, just come before God and surrender every part of yourself to him. The fifth thing is this, that I believe that there's an atmosphere of worship that can so invite the presence of God. So if this is something you desire, worship him. Pray and get into that atmosphere where the Holy Spirit is just so very present. And lastly, is I believe that if you truly desire the baptism of the Holy Spirit, the Bible does talk about the teaching of laying on of hands. There's something very powerful that happens when a believer lays hands on another person and prays for them for the infilling and the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And so you can see the references there in the book of Acts. But at the end of Acts chapter 2, just to wrap this teaching up tonight, Peter gave one of the most powerful sermons of all time. And the crowd was so moved and so convicted that they asked Peter, "What shall we do?" And his answer was simple when he said in Acts 2, verse 38 and 39, he literally just said, "You need to repent, you need to be baptized, and you need to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." See, what Peter was trying to communicate to them that day was that it's impossible to live the Christian life apart from the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit. From the moment that we're born again, God supplies the power that we need to be consistent witnesses for Christ. So I don't know about you, but I want everything that God has already provided for this journey so that I can be the most effective I can be for his kingdom, doing his business. So church, let's surrender completely. Let's obey his commands and let's receive his provision. Thank you, church, for joining us tonight.